So I've been messing around the new Total War campaign. I started with Yanshu because apparently he's the hardest and I wanted a challenge. I did a campaign for 56 turns and I was pretty much doing everything all wrong. So today I was going to do a fresh run through as Yang Shao. However, I was looking more into his legitimacy mechanic, seeing as it is a bit confusing when I stumbled across this guy's guide, and it's an absolutely sick guide. Shout out to this guy. I'll put a link to his guide in the comments. But essentially, if done correctly, we can get the legendary warrior Lu Bu on like turn 7. And so at the start of this video, we're going to run through this guy's guide and we're going to try to get an epic start on this Yanshu campaign. So the first thing to note is we start with random items. I think this starts actually really good because we have two decent horses. This one's exceptional, which is the second best quality, and this one's refined, which is the third best quality. And then we got this follower who is also exceptional, and we got this common feather fan, which is the lowest quality. Evidently we don't even want to keep the items, we just want high quality ones, so we can do a trade deal with Sun Jian and we can get his imperial jade seal. The guy doesn't really specify why we want this item, but it's unique and it gives a lot of nice stats, and he'll actually take it for just two of our items. All right, so we'll equip the jade seal. It gives 10 authority, which is going to give us 2 unit morale to our retinue and 1 satisfaction. Satisfaction boosts the happiness of our nobles and generals, which is important because if it gets down to 0, then they'll leave us. It also gives prestige, which 25 prestige is actually a lot. It helps us rank up, and each time we rank up, we get a bunch of powerful bonuses. All right, so we're ready to start off the campaign like you normally would. We'll also give Yanshu this horse, which gives him more charge bonus. That's not in the guide. This is just a lucky item we got. And then we'll fight Jia Kong. We have a 58% chance of capturing him, and I save before this battle. If we don't capture him, then I'm just gonna reload until I capture this guy. It would be a very easy thing to do to restart the game to capture him. But since I'm not doing like a speed run, and you guys would never know if I did reload because I'm not streaming, which I actually might be doing, so follow my Twitch at twitch.tv/3man as I'm getting a new streaming PC in the next few days. The plan is we're gonna bring our cavalry over to the left here, and I just did this battle and I made the mistake of bringing the cavalry to the right, and if you charge uphill you get a charge penalty and your cavalry move really slowly. So we definitely want to attack from the left. We want to wait till their militia get in the archer's cone of fire. Okay, they're there now. Now we're gonna charge in with our cavalry, and they're actually already getting pelted by arrows, so we're gonna use our block ability, which gives units a 100% chance to block range attacks for 30 seconds. This should give our cavalry enough time to break into their archer line, and these G militia are just chilling here. They're not moving at all, like they're not guarding their archers, and we're just breaking into their archer line. And I think their archers are actually, yeah, they're done for. Meanwhile, their melee units are charging into our archers. Die! At least one of them is. And now we'll send in our infantry to take them out. And we'll pop evasion as well. It gives units a 50% melee evasion for 20 seconds. The enemy unit flees! And what their powers? Militia are fleeing now. Meanwhile, these G militia decide to chase our cavalry. And our archers should be able to tear them apart. They're still chasing while getting pounded by arrows. And this dude's actually running, and I think they're gonna be routing pretty soon. And they decide to rout because they lost too much morale. I really hope we captured him there because that was a really good outcome. I don't think we lost many units at all. Like, we have 752 left, which means we lost like, did we lose any? Wait, I don't think we lost a single unit.
Each victory brings stability to the realm.
Okay, you guys. Oh, we captured him. Yes. And we can actually employ him. He's got actually pretty decent traits. He's got no negative traits. The part of hiring this guy wasn't in the guide, and it does cost us 200 income per turn to hire him, so that might go against what we're trying to do. Hopefully not though. One thing you guys got to understand about this battle is while I was learning this game, I did it probably 30 to 40 times because I just kept doing playthroughs. On average, until I found the cavalry kite strat, I would lose probably 50 units, maybe even 100. The best I've ever done is like 20, and the fact that we lost absolutely none there is just insane. Just because like on their infantry charge, we should have lost some units, but with evasion popped, and I was also fighting their general with my general, so he wasn't getting any kills. I don't know, losing 0 units there is absolutely crazy to me. We'll ransom the rest of his troops, and I think his army's done for because he joined us. Also, there's an option to take military supplies that turn, but don't do it because you get 30 for completing that quest, and it caps you out at 100. I'm actually just going to save there in case I mess up anything else, because that was just a way too epic of a start. All right, next he says to take the Jade Mine. He also says in the guide to delegate this. It basically just means the AI fights it for us, and we lose 228. I'm interested to see if we can do this better, and if I actually fight it, will we lose less units? No matter where we attack from, we'll be getting hit by 4 arrow towers. However, I do have a strategy that I want to try. I'm going to start everyone over here, and this makes the AI start with the majority of their troops defending these towers. We're then going to try to fake them out, and we're going to move all of our units all the way over here. It's much easier to attack from this side because they only have 2 towers that can hit us until we get very close, and then these towers can hit us as well. But they actually did move their units away. Can we just capture this? We're not going to make it. We didn't make it. Oh wait, we did make it. We almost captured it. Oh crap, we got to get back in there. If the generals are in there, we actually capture it, even if they have a bunch of units in there. No way, we actually control the towers. Okay, wait, can we bring our generals over here and capture these 2 towers too? All right, so we capture this tower. This cavalry are chasing us. Let's try to pull them back. So we managed to kind of break through. We're not getting bombarded by any towers anymore. I don't know what the enemy is really doing here though. Like, we keep advancing on them and they just keep retreating further and further back into their base. They don't get anything for defending up here, I don't think, except for it actually does give a morale bonus to the defender when held. If we do take this capture point though, I think it will be a big morale hit to them. This is gonna be kind of hard to take though, because they do have 3 units just sitting on the capture point. We're actually capturing it because we have the generals in here. I think they have like a higher capture bonus or something, because the enemy seems like they have a lot more units in this capture point. I just don't know about this one though. Like, I do feel like we've already taken more casualties than we would have taken. Also, one thing to note is we lost pretty much all of our horsemen, which are weighted much higher than like infantry. We're at 469, so we definitely lost more than 228. Wow, the automatic battle is just way better there. All right, so I just loaded back to the delegated outcome. Another good thing about this outcome is we did end up losing less cavalry. It's just crazy to me that the delegated outcome was so good, because I really don't think I could have fought that much better. One thing I think this guy might have missed in the guide, or maybe he just didn't do this for whatever reason, is there's this option that I can make people support legitimacy. And like, for example, Sun Yan is very friendly with us, so it's very easy to make him support our legitimacy. And like, we could actually give him this feather fan, and I think he might do it. If we give him 495 and this feather fan, then he will do it. And this gives us 40 relation with him. Doing that gives us 8 extra legitimacy per turn. And legitimacy is pretty important. I'll explain more later on as to why. I'm hoping that doing that is not going against the guide in some way. This guy then hires Yan Xiang, and he doesn't really explain why, but I think this upgrade is really good resourcefulness. It gives 10 military supplies in enemy territory. If we are in enemy territory, if they get below 0, we'll start losing units per turn. So this guy's upgrade will essentially just allow us to stay in enemy territory longer before running out of military supplies. We're actually still on turn 1, so we have to end the turn. Okay, so we start off turn 2 by hiring Yan Xiang. He says he replaces the cavalry and unique unit in Yan Shu's army to get some more money rolling in, but he doesn't say with what. Maybe he just disbands them because the cavalry unit is costing 130 per turn and there's only 30 of them, so I'm guessing they're just not super optimal to have early game, and we'll disband this thing too. It costs 200 per turn, so it is really expensive. And the problem with this unit is it's really weak against archers and it's not very tanky in melee. It just does a lot of melee damage, so I could definitely see why he dropped this. Next he says he gets this guy up to 5 archers, so there we go. And Yanshu has an upgrade. He doesn't say what he gets in the guide, but nobility is pretty good. It gives 8 authority and +1 available assignments. He also doesn't talk about assignments, but we do currently have 2 assignment slots. Whoever we choose to do an assignment gets XP per turn. And I'm thinking we want to do one with Jia Kong. He can stimulate the markets for 75% more income from commerce, which most of our income is coming from commerce, so that's going to give us some more income per turn. And we'll have Yan Inyang do tax collection, which gives us 50% more income from peasantry. And that does absolutely nothing because we have no peasantry income. We don't want to do business ventures because it loses 6 legitimacy per turn, and we're not getting that much income right now, so it's really not worth it. But if we do have her do tax collections, she's going to start gaining XP. Also, we can upgrade our buildings or build new ones, but in the guide he says specifically not to do that yet. And he actually shows a screenshot of his army. He had 2 spearmen in Yan Shao's group, so we'll just do that. Then he says to move up to the lumberyard's border, and we end turn here so we can replenish some more units. And then for this turn he says to attack the lumberyard, and he says to delegate, which I'm sure again is going to be a better outcome. We lost 98. Like, I don't even feel the need to fight that. I already know that we're gonna probably lose more than 98 if we do fight it. Like, we just don't have that many good units, so we're gonna probably take casualties no matter what. Alright, now we have a reform, and he doesn't specify which one, meaning that we can kind of just pick whichever one we want, and I don't think it should impact the overall strategy. We're just gonna go for mercantile regulation, giving us 15% more income from commerce, which will just give us a slight boost to income. And Sun Yan wants us to sign a non-aggression pact with him. This is not in the guide, but it's only gonna cost us 64, and so I think we'll do this. It gives us 20 relation with Sun Yan, and we lose some relation with Dong Zuo, which is completely fine. And this dude is actually fighting us. This is not how this is supposed to go down. This dude is supposed to lay an ambush. He's not supposed to attack the lumberyard, and we're eventually supposed to ambush him, which would give us a huge tactical advantage against him. But I think this might actually be even better, as he's attacking the lumberyard, so we have towers to help us. We definitely will fight this one because it says it predicts a defeat. I think the reason why is this dude has a lot of cavalry, but one thing we do have going for us is they are very weak against range because they have no shields. So the towers should shred them, and we have a lot of archers who should shred them. I'm thinking since they're lined up in the middle here, they're only going to charge this middle tower. And yeah, they're all charging for the wrong one. That's kind of a yikers. Now the question is, if we put all of our units on this side, will they instead charge these towers? It looks like they are actually splitting up slightly. They are sending some lancers over to this side. Okay, so it looks like this strat is to put some of our weaker melee units on this side and the majority of them on this side. With the archers, it doesn't really matter that much because I think these guys can reach over here. And like ordinarily, I wouldn't reload this much, but I'm just kind of trying to perfect this strat and to see like what's the most optimal thing to do. These cavalry aren't really sure if they want to charge the right side or the left side. They decided that they're going to charge the left side this time. I think the play is to send our melee units out and charge at them. Oh, these guys are not fire at will too. Okay, that's a yikers. That might honestly be a reload right there. Our archers were not set to fire at will. All right, here we go. Will our lines hold? I did pop evasion, so we have that going for us. The halberds do counter horsemen. So that's good. And one of their generals is already running. And there goes some more mounted lancer militias. Another general's gone. Some G militia are running. So I believe there is an RNG chance if we do capture their generals. One of them died, unfortunately. And we did capture GOC. This guy's got three positive traits, I think. Superstitious may randomly trigger superstition events for their owning faction. It's gray, so I think it means those events could be positive or negative. We will employ him though. And again, I'm hoping this is not going to mess with the strat because this is going to cost us 125 per turn. We'll ransom his units for 530. We only ended up losing 173, which I think is pretty good. This option then pops up and Sun Yan is being attacked by Liu Bao. If we do aid him, I've actually experienced this before. Liu Bao will send his entire army over and attack you. So we have to let him perish. It loses 80 relation with Sun Yan. He says this turn we colonize the imperial city of Luoyang, but Dong Zuo is right here and he's kind of weak. I'm wondering hypothetically if we could attack him here. He has Dong Zuo's armor, which is a unique armor piece, and this blade of Xiang Yu, which is a really good sword. He doesn't say we do this in the guide, but I wonder what would happen if we were to take out Dong Zuo here. I did save, and we'll try it out and see what happens. Towards destiny. Oh, he actually runs. Avoid diversions. No mercy. Oh, we got him actually. He's only got 33 units, and there's a 25% chance to capture him. The question now is, do we save load until we capture Dong Zuo? I'm pretty sure we do, because if we do capture him, I don't think he'll join us, but I think we can execute him and take his armor and weapon. We'll delegate, and I'm pretty sure we should win easily. Those who oppose harm, we lost 183, ouch. Oh, we capture him first try, and he will not join us. But we actually capture him first try, and like, you guys won't believe me when I say that, but it did happen. And if we do execute him, we get this Blade of Xiang Yu. It gives an insane amount of damage, and the 40 charge bonus is also crazy. Unfortunately, we don't get the armor. This might mess up the guide though, because I think the guy that we're trying to recruit is his son. Yeah, Lu Bu is a friend of his, and this is gonna piss off Lu Bu. Well, I did save, so if this messes up the entire thing, then we'll just revert.
The tyrant is dead.
And he gets succeeded by Dongmin, his son, I believe. Yeah, now Dongmin really does not like us, so I think that may make it harder to get Lu Bu to join us. Next, we're going to head over to Lu Yang. It's going to take us two turns, and we should have already been there last turn, so we will be a bit late on the guide. Was it worth the sword? I think definitely, if Lu Bu will still join us. All right, so we finally got to the settlement of Lu Yang, and it costs 8k to establish order here. I don't really know why that costed 8k, as all Lu Yang is currently is an empty plot of land. It's literally deserted, and there's 5k people here. I don't know what we spent 8k for. But anyways, back to the guide. Now we're supposed to make peace with Dong Zuo, who is currently dead, but we can make peace with his son, Dong Min. In the guide, he gives over the city we just settled, which is Lu Yang and Lu Yang's lumberyard, and that's all he needs to do, I believe. Because we killed Dong Zuo and our relation with them is even worse than it was, we're gonna have to give them something else. We got this extra follower who's kind of crappy, and then we'll just give him a bunch of money. If we give him 2300, he'll take it. And so overall, that wasn't actually too bad. I do still think it's going to make our other deals that we do with him a bit harder, which is this one, marry Lu Bu to Yan Inyang. It's going to only take 21.1. That's not too bad. We'll give him the inspector, which is an exceptional follower. We also have these two horses. One is refined and this one is exceptional, and he's almost going to take this. We just have to give him a little bit more. We'll just give him some money, I guess. How much money does he want? 2000 even, and Lu Bu is ours. Our relation with him starts at zero, and it's actually worse than it should be because we killed his father. The main reason why our relation with him is so bad is because he's level 7, and the higher level units get, the better court position they want. And so unfortunately for a young 15-year-old Yang Yao, he is no longer the heir. Lu Bu is now going to be the heir, and he is now at 94 satisfaction. So I think we're good. Like, I think this guide's actually over with. There is one thing I did mess up on. First of all, you can do the marriage and peace in the same screen, which does not matter. If we do this option where we make regular payments to Dong Min, this makes it so we give him 1300 per turn for 10 turns, and that gives us 15 points towards the negotiation. This means we only have to give him the inspector, this attendant, and maybe even just this crappy horse. Like, it's not a crappy horse, it's not common, but it's not as good as the exceptional one. And yeah, so we actually don't have to give him any money, just Lu Yang, the lumberyard, the three items, and then the regular payment. And now we are paying Dong Min 1.3k per turn for 10 turns, which would total up to be 13k. However, if we do declare war on him, this gives us actually good relation with other people. No one except for Dongmin seems to think that this is a bad idea, even though we just declared peace with him. However, if we do this, we become treacherous, which I believe does impact how other factions view us and their relation with us. Most of this only lasts for 10 turns though. The only lasting repercussion is this -5, and I think that's permanent. And now we're not paying him anything. Let's see, does Lu Bu have anything to say about that? Nope, he doesn't care. Also, we did just give Dongmin Lu Yang, which was a pretty big part of the treaty, but I think we can literally just capture it back. Maybe next turn? And so yeah, we can actually just occupy the settlement. That's pretty much the guide though. And we now have Lu Bu, who is level 7, a legendary character, and his traits are actually insane. 40 expertise, 15 resolve, and 25 instinct. His weapon is Sky Piercer. It loses 15 expertise, which gives him less melee evasion, but it gives 24 instinct, which gives more melee damage. And we have Lu Bu's armor, 80 base armor, which is a lot, 6 expertise for some extra evasion, 15 instinct for some more damage, less chance to be captured if he loses, 12% more speed, and 5% more melee attack rate. The main thing about the armor though is the 80 armor base is insanely high. And then he has this unique mount, 70 speed, 2.5k mass, and 50 charge bonus. What I'm gathering with this horse is that the mass makes it larger so that if he charges into a group of units, it will take out more of them. That combined with the charge bonus and the fact that it has 70 speed is pretty insane. Like for example, this horse has 58 speed, 2k mass with a 20 charge bonus, and it's exceptional. It's only one tier below unique, but this one's just so much better. Since he's level 7, he also has a bunch of upgrades, like for example Zeal, which gives him 40% more melee attack rate, and he has mighty knockback, which causes extra damage when he knocks back enemies. His retinue gets more charge speed, and I think that applies to him as well. More charge bonus, reduces enemy morale to units that are around him, has his own move Rage of Lu Bu, which does splash damage. The last thing he did, which is something he explained as just being a personal preference, was he dumped Yan Shao out of the army. I like the idea of dumping Yan Shu at least pretty early on, as by dumping him at this point you save 500 200 per turn, and his abilities just really aren't that good in PvP. We're gonna need all the money we can get, because turning Lubu into a general costs 10k and 890 per turn. So we added Lubu to the army, we turn him into the commanding general, and we'll be leading our forces into the lumberyard, which we did just give to Dong Min, but we'll be taking that back. They only have 225. I wonder if Lubu could just take them all out by himself.
Victory will be borne upon my back. To battle!
It's almost as if he knew I was going to try to make him solo this. Alright, so unfortunately the enemy does have these G infantry captains, and charging into those would be kind of suck. We'll instead have him charge into these archer militia. Wait, let's do the splash attack. Oh. They're running already. He's gonna take a lot of damage. Yeah, he took a bunch of damage from that charge. Cause what the halberdmen do is they reflect the damage that they take from charges. So he did a bunch of damage on the charge and it was all reflected back at him. And these pikemen are trying to charge out at our army. We can't have that. He is actually so fast. And if he charges on that, he's actually gonna kill himself. Let's have him dismount, and then let's just have him fight. And then he won't be charging this way. Rage of Lubu. Yep, they're running. Alright, let's try these guys now. We don't have the Rage of Lubu up, but... Yep, and they're running. He actually almost did get killed there. That was really close. 126 units killed by Lubu on that fight.
So you will break.
Ooh, Yan Shao declares war on us. They are rank 5, and their strength compared to ours is superior. One thing I also forgot to do was to give this Blade of Xiang Yu to someone. It can be used by the purple guys, the blue, and the yellow, but we're definitely going to give it to Yang Hong. This dude next level gets Zeal, which gives him 40% more melee attack rate. The next play here is we could either go for the city of Yingchan, or we could go for Liu Yang's trade port, which would be on the way towards the city of Chang'an. If we do capture this city, we control Emperor Xian, and controlling this guy is a unique event in this game where the Han Empire will become my vassal. We also have 2200 this turn, which means that we should start building up Nanyang's economy. Currently, Nanyang's public order is terrible, which means that it is losing 4k population per turn. In order to fix that, we'll give them tax exemption for a few turns, which will start raising the public order by a lot. And we should also probably do land development, which gives more food production per turn and more pop growth and some income. We should also probably upgrade Liu Yang to a small town, which is going to cost 1k, and that is all of our money. But in 4 turns, it will actually be a town and not just an empty plot of land. Is he going to attack us? Oh, he actually is. Our forces are evenly matched. Our advisors predict a valiant defeat. Ooh, they do have a lot of pikemen, which is kind of scary. And Lubu is only half HP. Dude has a 0% chance to get captured. One thing I was noticing when we were attacking the lumberyard earlier is he was not taking any damage from ranged projectiles. The only damage he took was the reflected damage from the enemy's pikemen, which was damage he was basically inflicting upon himself. The plan is we want our bowmen to be fighting their G militia, which is their pikemen. We'll have our horses try to take on their cavalry, and we'll have Lubu just go for the archers by himself. He just took out 5, 10. Let's use Rage of Lubu. Oh. Wait, is that one dead? I feel like he did so much damage to that archer group. These guys are running, but they're not routed yet. Like, they're in skirmish mode, so... Oh, never mind, they're not. They're just running. And what about these guys? How long are they gonna last? Rage of Lubu. It's kind of a waste, though. These guys are about to run anyways. Oh, they're definitely running. They're not routed yet, actually. There they go. Like, right here, they're not fully... Like, there we go. When it's transparent like that, I think they'll just permanently run. I don't think they'll be coming back anytime soon. And there they go. That guy wants to duel our general. I got a better idea. How about we just have Lubu take her out? And the girl is not doing too good for herself. Yep, she's dead. I literally felt like Brad Pitt there in the Battle of Troy, and whenever I think of that movie, I feel like I have to watch it. I'm just trying to fish for comments for the algorithm, but seriously, like, do you guys have any movies like that where, like, if you hear a mention of it or, like, you see some image that's connected to the movie, like, you just gotta watch it? 274 kills for Lu Bu. I'm guessing, like, 260 of those were archers, and we only ended up losing 320 units, and we captured Kai Yong, and his traits are actually all good. Nothing negative. The funny thing about that battle is it said we should have lost it, and we obviously did not end up losing it. There's a Han Empire general here, and Dongmin's general is still alive, but we don't care about that. We're just gonna head into the trade port. It actually looks like we can't get into the trade port for a few more turns. It's gonna take a whole turn to get here, and then another whole turn to get here, because we're going through the forest, I guess. At least we're ending turn inside of our borders. Like, you can see the little border line right here. And so that means that we do regenerate a bit next turn. And we got a rank up, which gives us a bunch of nice stuff. That was pretty early, I feel. So it's turn 13. It opens up another assignment slot, so we can assign Yan Inyang, and that will give her XP. And we've also been leveling up Guo Xi as well, who is actually really good, and I'll go more into why he's good later on. And we can now also issue an administrator for Nan Yang. Yang Hong makes a super good administrator with his 10% more income from all sources, minus 13% construction cost, which is really good because I'm going to start building a lot of buildings at Nan Yang. The only negative is plus one mustering turns, which doesn't really matter that much. Apparently it only applies to freshly recruited units, so it's really not that big of a deal. And we have a fairly interesting situation on our hands. Lu Bu is now being cornered by Zhang Liao, Dongmin's general, and Jia Zhu, which is the general we took out earlier. He's really weak, but Zhang Liao is not. So this could be a bit bad for Lu Bu. If we go further this way, we're going to be heading into their territory, and we're going to start losing military supplies. And if we're in their territory, we will also stop replenishing units and healing up. So there's two main options that we could do here. The first one being is we could set up an ambush. And if we're in this hilly forest, it says there's an 80% ambush success chance. So let's try this and see if it works. Setting up ambush, I guess, loses line of sight, and the AI either didn't want to pursue or didn't know where I was. I want to try stance in camp, and this essentially just fortifies our position. Will they attack us? And yeah, they actually will. Our advisors predict a decisive defeat, and I can kind of see why. They have these spear guards, which are Lu Bu's kryptonite. They're anti-cavalry, and another thing that's good about them is they have shields, so they're fairly tanky against archers. So they're attacking from this side, and we have, I believe, two towers over here and one tower on either corner. The corner towers can't really hit them as long as they're charging straight into our capture point. And these archers actually have fire arrows, which is completely destroying our towers. So we'll send Lu Bu out and hopefully he can take care of these archers. And yeah, those guys are actually completely done. All right, so we took out both those groups of archers. We're still getting bombarded on this side by these archers, though.
The enemy general is fallen.
What about this general? He's going berserk. 40% melee damage. I don't know why he just got full HP. Okay, we're just gonna use Rage of Lu Bu. On top of the fact that he has this fallen friend buff. That did not feel good. This general has been up for too long. We need to take him out. Oh, that hurt. That did not feel good either. Oh, you didn't have to kill him, dude.
Literally one man army again, dude.
He got so many kills that time. Like, I'm pretty sure he got even more. I wonder what happened to their generals too. Like, I wonder how many we captured and stuff. 1200 money gained, and we captured Zhang Liao. This guy's actually really good, I think. His traits are also decent. The only negative is he does get fatigued a bit easier, which I don't think is a huge deal. And we actually captured three of their generals. Oh, and we actually can't play him, so never mind. There's no real point of talking about it. Freaking Lu Bu, I think, maimed him. And now he has permanent negative 4 expertise and negative 5% melee damage. That's what happens when you get into combat with Lu Bu. I think we will just release him for the extra money, because we are pretty low on money right now. And we actually captured Jia Zhu as well. This guy will join us, so let's look at his traits, and they're actually all good. This one's actually pretty cool, minus 15% chance of discovery when performing spy options. I wonder if that means he can spy. We'll ransom the rest of their troops for 720, wow. Alright, let's see what Zhang Liao's got. He's got fire arrows for his retinue, and precision, more ranged armor piercing damage, and ranged firing rate. And he's got Roar of the Beast, which lowers morale for units around him. And this thing is actually really good. 25% increased chance of capturing enemy officers post-battle when present. That is actually a reason why we would want to have him around very early on in battles. And he actually has his own unique chest piece. Oh wait, he's legendary. What is this run, dude? Like, I literally did not load a save there at all. Well, I did load after we prepared the ambush and they just left, just because I didn't know how the mechanic worked. But like, it's not like I save loaded until I captured him. Like, I literally captured him on the first battle. He's also got this refined military Xian, which isn't all that good. It's only second tier quality. He really likes Zhang Lao. He commends his physical strength. With great strength comes great potential. I just don't know about Zhang Lao's upgrade path. Like, he's a melee unit, but he gives archer upgrades. It's kind of weird. We could upgrade Liu Yang to a town, but I think the better play is actually to save money, and we can then put Zhang Lao on the field. Dude costs 3750 and 655 per turn. But he has 6 units, and I feel like he could definitely hold Liu Yang by himself and just kind of repel off any invaders that try to attack us. And we can actually chase these guys down if we want to.
Cut them down! Lay waste to them!
Not running.
Leave none alive.
Oh, Cheng Yi is all on his own, and there's a 62% chance to capture him. He's cowardly. He has a much higher chance to not get captured and loses 10 morale, so he routes easier. Oh, and he won't join us. Never mind. We'll just release him for 500. Screw it. We can take the extra money. And then Wang Kung was across the river just watching that brutality all play out.
We will settle this on the battlefield.
Cao Cao declared war on us. They're ranked 2, and their strength is superior. So not only are we fighting Yan Shao, we're also fighting Cao Cao.
Diplomacy has failed.
And Wang Kung is now declared war against us. So we made it to Liu Yang's trade port. We have 800 units while they have 1200. They have 200 of these archer captains, which have 98 range power. 120 medium bow infantry, which have 68 range power.
Have faith in me. I will carry us to victory.
Hope so, man. The thing about this battle is if we do take too many casualties, Wang Kung's main army is really close by, so we're probably gonna have to fight him afterwards. It's definitely best to attack this place from the left, seeing as these towers are completely avoidable. So as long as we just stay out of their line of sight, we'll only be running into 2 towers. We're gonna start on the complete opposite side. Doing this makes them put all their units on this side, and we're gonna try to loop around with our cavalry and generals, staying out of the range of their towers, and hopefully they just don't react to this, and we can take the towers on the left for free. I think they would react if we brought the entire army over here, but as it is right now, they're not reacting in any way. So the plan is we're gonna send Lu Bu in first, as these towers really don't do much damage to him at all. And he's drawing all the arrow fire.
Our comrade is under attack.
For the most part. Actually, this cavalry is getting destroyed. But yeah, we got the capture point, and they finally are reacting, but they're only sending their archers over here. This might be just an easy clap for Liu Bu, although we are running into these towers.
Strike them down.
We'll have our other generals just go for them.
Run! Look, the enemy run!
Those archers are already running, that's good. Now they're starting to react with their infantry, but one thing about these guys is they have no pikemen. So Liu Bu might be free to just do what he wants here. The question is, do we send in the rest of the army and have them tank the tower fire? We can actually capture this capture point and they won't even take any fire now that I think about it. Alright, Liu Bu captured this capture point, so now we can bring the rest of our units in. We probably should have done that a bit earlier. Oh, that was a big one. Ooh, nice. That was actually a really good outcome. We only lost 52. Did we kill every single one of them? That's not ideal, because if they did have survivors, we could have used them to replenish some of our troops, which we desperately need to do. Most of the units we lost were our really good cavalry, and our generals are actually really weak as well. But now we have this coastal trading port, which is giving us 5 prestige and 140 extra commerce income. The thing is, there is Zhang Jiang, who I think was heading over here to take this trade port for herself. So she might not like that, and maybe she'll declare war against us, I don't know. I could definitely see Wang Kung attacking us in the trade port though next turn, and I don't know if it's gonna have any garrison. Like, the entire garrison did just get wiped out, so I'm assuming it won't, at least for a few turns. Zhang Jiang wants us to do a non-aggression pact. As long as we give her 1 food and we give her Tunic of Divination. That is decent for like our strategist, because more cunning gives our archers more more ammo, but it's not by a whole lot, I don't think. And I would actually like to sign a non-aggression pact with her because it's going to give us good relation with her. So we'll take the deal. And here we go. Wang Kung is attacking us in the trade port. And this is his main army. He himself, the faction leader, leads it, as well as he has his faction heir present, who by the looks of it is legendary because her name is Golden. She does have this bodyguard companion, which gives 10 melee evasion to the retinue. I would definitely like to pick that up, as well as her. Like, if she joins us, I think that'd be really cool to kind of see what abilities she has. So I'm wondering if we should do a save load here until we capture her. I'm thinking I might, because I do really want to know what her abilities are. And like, for example, if I were to do a cleaner playthrough without doing any save loading, I would want to know if she's someone that I should pursue. And like I said, I do have a streaming PC coming in a few weeks. And when that comes, I might stream myself doing a clean playthrough of this game. I'm going to be doing a dual PC setup, and I should be able to stream at really high quality. And whether I stream or not just kind of depends on the feedback that this video gets. I haven't put out a video for like 4 days, and so I think I'm going to end this video right here. In my next video, we'll continue the campaign, and I'm going to try to finish it all in one single video. Did you guys like this? Would you eventually like to see another Total War campaign? And like, do you think streaming this game is a good idea? Let me know in the comments. And yeah, thank you all for watching. I will see you in the next video.